Hello, and welcome to this forum for Unified School District Board candidates. I'm Carl Frederick, Managing Editor at the Kenosha News, and I will be moderating this forum. On April 2nd, two candidates will be elected to the Kenosha Unified School District Board. On February 19th, voters in the city of Kenosha, the village of Pleasant Prairie, and the town of Summers that comprise the district will be going to the polls to make a decision on narrowing the field from five candidates down to four. Candidates seeking election to the board are David Gallo, Sam Martin, William Maurer, Kyle Flood, and Rebecca Stevens. Each candidate will answer six questions I have chosen from a list submitted from respondents to a school district social media post or by email directly to the district spokeswoman. They posted the message seeking questions on January 23rd and closed that on Monday. The way the forum will work is each candidate will be allowed a 2 to 3 minute opening statement. Each candidate will then have 2 minutes to answer each of the six questions. There will be no time allowed to rebut any answer from any candidate. Any rebuttal that is necessary or chosen to be made will be made in the candidate's closing statements. A different candidate will be the first to answer each of the questions. And at the end, each candidate will be allowed a 2 to 3 minute closing statement. We'll begin with opening statements with Mr. Gallo.
Thank you, Mr. Frederick. As stated, my name is David Gallo, and I am running for re-election to the school board. I'm just finishing up my first three-year term, and I'm currently serving as the board's vice president. I was born and raised here in Kenosha. I attended schools through KUSD, graduated Tremper in 1986. Both of my children attend schools here in Kenosha. One's a junior, one's a senior in high school. I've been married for 20 years. I work here in Kenosha for a large mechanical contracting company. I'm their operations manager. I'm a volunteer football coach at Lance Middle School, and I'm a property taxpayer. I first ran for the board because I wanted to get involved. I wanted to help make a difference. I wanted to give back to the community that's given so much to me and my family. And I believe I've done a lot of that. I'm running for re-election because although there's been some very positive things happen over the last 3 years, there's a lot more left to do. And I still have more that I'm willing to do and more than I'm willing to give.
Thank you. Mr. Martin.
I'm Sam Martin. I'm not seeking a board seat to push a personal agenda or oppose a certain political ideology. The reason I'm running is to get back to the basic functions of a well-run school system that provides a world-class education through parents' involvement, teacher commitment to 21st century learning, and administrators that are accountable, effective, innovative, and open. I respect the work of my predecessors and will be fully prepared to fulfill my duties and responsibilities as a member of the KUSD Board of Education from day one. Thank you.
Mr. Maurer.
Good evening. My name is William Maurer. I'm running for the school board and I've got questions. Like most of you, I'm a KUSD property taxpayer. Every December, I open my property tax bill and wonder if all that money going to the district is being used in the best interest of the children. I have questions for the board, the administration, and the teachers. Because I'm not beholden to any special interest, I'm free to ask anyone anything and be the taxpayer's representative for the children. When I vote for a budget, it will be taxpayer approved. We're spending $316 million on education. To me, that's a lot of money. Why are we not doing a better job educating the children? Each dollar provided by the taxpayer at every level must be used in the best interest of quality education. My business experience enables me to look at complex budgets, financial statements, and policies, and ask questions in a manner that everyone can understand and not stop until the answers make sense. A wise person once told me, "You don't know what you don't know." Well, I'm here to find out why our public education process is not achieving the results one would expect for the amount of resources it consumes. During the campaign and after I'm on the board, the public will be able to follow my questions on the web site, MauerForSchoolBoard.com, and contribute their own questions and participate in open dialogue on Facebook at MauerForSchoolBoard.com. My name is William Mauer. I've got questions. And when I tell you it's all about the kids, you can take that to the bank because they're the special interest I owe my allegiance to.
Mr. Flood.
My name is Kyle Flood. I decided to run for the board recently, but I've been being pressured to do so for about a year now. When the transformation plan was rolled out, we saw a lot of changes in the district, and I saw a lot of hurting in the district. Outside of the transformation plan, I am too, like everyone else, concerned with the way taxpayer dollars are being funded. I don't believe that the budget currently supports what taxpayers are paying for, and that's educating students. I'd like to see lower class size and more money put into security. I believe that we need to update and strictly enforce all of the policies in KUSD, especially the 5000 series that covers students. We also need to increase communication with teachers, parents, and students. I have created a plan called Putting KUSD on Top. I feel that the transformation plan only aims for proficiency, while my plan will push students towards student excellence.
Thank you. Ms. Stevens.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Rebecca Stevens, and I am running for my third term on school board. I have been fortunate and blessed to be able to have the opportunity to serve our community and the students of Kenosha Unified. That is the only reason I ran for school board to begin with. I know that my number one duty as a school board member is to advocate for children, and that is what I want to continue to do. Our district has gone through many changes over the years. The budget cuts from the state level have created a lot of extra pressure on everyone here in Kenosha Unified, including the school board. I want to be able to ask my questions in the open forum, in the business meeting of the district. I want to be able to make sure that we continue to have transparency, involvement from all the different groups that are part of this community, students, parents, teachers, different community members, and representatives from all groups that work in KUSD. I believe our strongest resource in this district are our employees, and they have many of the answers and can help us solve the problems that now currently exist in Kenosha Unified School District. I would ask that you would vote for me again. I will support you. I will do my very best for students, and that is why I am here and running again. Thank you.
So we can begin. We start with, since David's on the far left, the first question: do you support the transformation plan? If not, would you get rid of it or reform it? If you plan to reform it, what do you want to change?
Plenty of questions wrapped up in there. I do support the transformation plan. It is still, I think, in its infancy. It's only been rolled out for about a year and a half now. It is changing consistently. And when you ask, you know, what I would change in it or if I would reform it, I don't know if we're so much reforming it as we are fine-tuning it. We know that things have to be changed in it, but they're small changes. They're very calculated changes that need to take place. And they will take place over time. Again, it's only been a year and a half, and I think what you're going to see roll out here is more changes through this second semester, and things are going to be much different going into next year when that begins again.
Sam?
Currently, I don't think that the transformation plan, whether you support it or you don't, is an option. I think that's the one that's on the table right now. I currently have a lot of concerns about the transformation plan, most of it doing with the community input. You hear teachers and you hear parents complain, and I don't think their questions are being answered, and that concerns me a lot. But right now, the only thing on the table right now is the transformation plan, so we have to work through that right now.
William.
I believe that the transformation plan needs the time to work. I'm sure that there are some things that need to be adjusted, minor adjustments, but I think we need to let it play out for a while. and see what the results of it really are. It is the plan on the table right now, and it just needs time to see what the results of it are, and then make a determination whether or not any major changes need to be made, or it should be continued or discontinued altogether.
Kyle?
I do not support the transformation plan. I have read the entire plan word for word many times. What I see in it is there it institutes teaching teachers to lead other teachers, which isn't something I think we need and that we see in the Delta Academy. During my meeting with Dr. Hancock, she told me that this is supposed to be helping move the district towards personalized learning and 21st century learning, but I can't see how putting students in multi-age classrooms and putting students in mixed ability level classrooms is moving towards the future. I see it as going more towards the past.
Rebecca.
I voted for the transformation plan under the conditions that it would be a fluid plan that would be continuously tweaked and guided and changed as necessary. As things have been brought to my attention, which I have a lot of concerns, I am meeting with parents, administrators, Dr. Hancock, and sharing my concerns. I think one of the problems that we had with all the budget cuts is we were moving forward dealing with a much smaller budget, but yet we were implementing so much change at once. So we had larger class sizes, less teachers, less time for training. Some of these things were out of our control, but we know that when we have issues and concerns, we have to talk about them, we have to address them, and we have to keep readdressing them until we get it tweaked out to where it needs to be. So as the transformation plan stands right now, I don't support it, but I think we are making headway and progress from some of the meetings that I've been attending, and I will continue to request that we get the changes we need to support our teachers and our students in the classroom.
What are your specific plans to involve teachers and their input in further transformation planning, which has so far been a pretty much top-down directive in many schools?
I think currently, under the union contract, there was avenues for conversations with the KEA representatives, whether it be the head of the union or the president. The handbook is going to put definitely a different challenge on it, on opening that line of communication. I am concerned about the handbook because it doesn't spell it out there on how teachers or their representatives, whether they be union or not, can voice their opinion. So that is one of my concerns.
William.
Well, I would go back and ask an overall question. Why don't we have the best teacher in every classroom? And why has seniority been allowed to undermine that concept? I'm sure there are many great teachers at Kenosha Unified, and as far as the transformation plan goes, I'm sure that their input, regardless of the handbook or the contract, allows them to communicate their opinions and their ideas. Will all of them be accepted and done? I don't think so. They are, in fact, employees of the system, and they work at the direction of the superintendent.
Kyle.
I believe that it is an extremely important thing to have teachers included in the conversation. The district currently spends about $1.4 million on consultants. I don't believe that's necessary. Teachers are experts in the field of education. It's what they went to school for, and therefore they should be the number one consultants for the district. I too am concerned with the handbook that it will only limit communication more than it already is.
Rebecca.
I definitely believe in teacher involvement, and I definitely believe in listening to them. I was at a meeting last night at one of the middle schools, and one of the hot topics right now is the honors program and the lack thereof. We've implemented an honors distinction program, and there are so many challenges based on that. So I went to a meeting last night, and there was a group of teachers there, a group of parents, the administrator for the building, and everyone sat down together and we spoke and we talked about the issues and the concerns and how we want to make sure that our students are getting the absolute best that we have to offer. Not ability grouping, achievement. Everything should be focused on reaching your highest potential in achievement. So I think we need to continue to look at this transformation plan. We need to support what our teachers are telling us. I listened to three teachers that were in a group together last night, and they teach together. And the things that they were saying, that they solved some of the problems from the beginning of the school year. And there are teachers that have been crying, have been completely stressed out, and really hard. It was hard to get to work. And it's not because they're not excellent teachers. It's just they've been spread extremely thin. These teachers sat down, their administrator was wise and said, I'm going to let you solve this problem. They came up with some great solutions, and it's exciting to listen to that. That's what I want to see more of in Kenosha Unified.
David.
Thank you. You know, and as mentioned, that's mostly a top-down directive, and to some point it would be. It starts with the superintendent and changes that she wants to see made and changes that she's asked to make from the board, and then rolls that down to her management team and then to the principals. Now, from the principals, it still trickles down to the teachers. Now, again, as I mentioned in the last question, as I answered it, it's a fluid process. There's more changes that are coming. The teachers have meetings and collaborate with each other. They have building meetings with the principal. We've got MAP testing that's taking place. These are all processes that need to go through to help improve the process and help improve the transformation plan. What I would do is I would stay the course. I would make sure to have the open lines of communication as we do. Do we need some improvement on it? Sure we do. But we stay the course. We keep the schools together the way they are. The classroom grouping isn't really the problem. Some of the problems we may be having, or some that I hear we're having, does come from communication with giving the teachers enough time for collaboration. So the changes I would make to it is make sure we're giving them the time to for the principals to meet with their teachers, the teachers to meet with each other to collaborate, and make sure the students are getting exactly what they need.
Thank you. The third question will begin with William. How would you give more support to the good teachers who are the first line of defense in the education of our children?
I would treat them, of course, as the professionals that they are, the good ones. But we have to remember that a system as a whole has to be able to remove the ones that shouldn't be there and have the processes to do that. Once we get to a point where we know we have the best in there, without seniority being allowed to undermine that concept, we can treat them as professionals and pay them accordingly. The governor has talked about giving more money to the school districts to reward good teachers, and I'm for rewarding professionals that truly deserve the pay and the benefits.
Kyle.
As I said in my last answer, I would include them in the conversation. It's extremely important that teachers are able to give their input on everything. They know what they're talking about. They know that ability grouping won't work because that's what they've learned in school. Teachers must be treated with respect. They need to be paid as they should be, and they need to be included in the conversation.
Okay. Rebecca.
Yes. Supporting teachers is obviously a number one concern of mine. If we don't have the very best teachers in the classroom, we know that our children will suffer. I feel that group of employees, you know, our group that we have for teachers are excellent. There's good and bad in everything. I think that to support teachers properly, though, again, we have to go back, we have to listen to them. They're the experts in their field. One of the things that they found out from meeting with the group last night and listening to them, that the stainine spread between the students within a class was just too far to be able to differentiate with the large class sizes. So it's a combination of large class sizes and the stainines and the ability grouping and those types of things that we need to really listen to the teachers on, because they can make these changes. They are trained professionally. They should be treated as the professionals they are. I don't know of any other field where a doctor or a lawyer or whatever it is, where you go to school and you work hard to earn your degree. You should be supported and treated with dignity and respect, and you should be sought out for answers to the problems and solutions to the problems, because you're the expert and you're in the trenches, you're in the field, so to speak. So I would continue to support that.
David.
Thank you. You had mentioned good teachers. We need to support all teachers. What represents a good teacher to a teacher that may need improvement? All of them need support. And we can support them starting with, and we know we have a problem with large class sizes. Class sizes have to come down. The teachers need time to collaborate amongst each other. They need development, professional development time. I do think they want more involvement, not only in the transformation plan, but the direction in which the district is going. And I do believe we need to give them that. I think if you talk to any teacher right now with the changes that we've been going through, they're facing burnout here, a lot of them, a lot of good teachers. We don't want to lose them. We have to support them. One of the biggest things is going to be reducing that class size, improving on our technologies that they can draw off of, and give them the time they need to be the professionals that they are.
I definitely wouldn't have a system that paid bonuses or rewarded teachers. I think it's too subjective. Currently, right now, the gap between the brand new employees, teachers coming on the workforce, and the older ones with seniority are too big of a gap. Sometimes it's almost three times the amount. So I would definitely try to close that gap, making sure that our lower paid employees are paid a little bit better coming out of school. I think that's it.
Okay. The fourth question will begin with Kyle. Which educational program in the district are you most impressed with, and which are you least impressed with?
I think it's hard to actually narrow it down to one program that I'm most impressed with. I think our athletics, our fine arts, they're all great. We have a very good business program, a very good world language program, English program. A lot of our programs are very good. What I'm not impressed with are things like multi-age classrooms or ability grouping. I'm not impressed with going back to the failed policies of the past, but I am impressed with our programs. I believe this district should be number one in Wisconsin with the type of programs that it has.
Rebecca.
Well, there's a lot that I'm impressed with. Today I had the opportunity to attend Dessa Rose at Bradford. The auditorium was filled with students from Lakeview, Harborside, and Reuther. I was so impressed not only with the production that was put on, and it was a long production, it's a couple, 2 hours. That's a long time for me to sit. And these students were so engaged and so part of listening to this program. The presentation was so professional that it kept their complete attention, and afterwards there was some great discussion that followed up. So of course the theater program, fine arts, our sports. I think too the opportunities that we have in our charter schools. We're a unique district in the fact that we created charter schools within KUSD. And we have some awesome opportunities. I know that Dave Gallo, for instance, has a child at one of the charters. I just am really impressed with the opportunities that we have within our system in KUSD. I think we need to keep building on the strengths that we have and our AP courses, all the opportunities that we offer for students to excel to their highest ability. I think we're doing a great job. I think we have some concerns and issues we need to address, but we're going to get through this and improve the district even more.
David.
Thank you. The program I'm most, or some of the programs I'm most impressed with here in our district, I would say one Rebecca had mentioned, our Youth Options program. We also have Project Lead the Way and our apprenticeship programs. These are very impressive programs. These are programs that a lot of other schools don't have. We've got kids who are gaining college credit while they're still getting high school credit, which is great for them. It opens them up to the college opportunity. It saves their parents a lot of money in the long run. But we're showing them that there's more than just school here, more than just high school. We've got our apprenticeship programs and our Project Lead the Way, where we're actually taking high school seniors. They're graduating and able to go right into jobs as CNC operators, polishers and welders. These are fantastic programs. I would say that's what impresses me the most. What I'm least impressed with, there are a few things. Seminar, the way we rolled out seminar, I think, is what I am least impressed with. But you're going to see next year, now that we're able to free up some monies and move them around, that seminar is going to go away. So that's going to be a very positive thing for our district.
Sam?
I think the best programs right now are extracurricular activities. Everyone mentioned it already. They teach leadership. They definitely have teacher involvement. The parents, the coaches, the directors of choir, they definitely do stuff for a very, very small monetary gain. But you see the parent involvement in those and how much effect it can have on the sports programs. And rolling right into the least impressive is just general education. Those same leadership things are missing in actual general education. Whether you talk about some of the programs that were discussed here, I just think the in the classroom you're really lacking.
William?
I'm most impressed with charter schools. Obviously the community is, there's a waiting list to get into them, and I think that the board should do whatever they can to accelerate opening more charter schools to make them available for all those that want to. Despite the board's insistence last Tuesday in their communication with Madison that they do not want vouchers, they very well could be coming anyway, so that's something else we have to deal with, and I believe that competition is a good thing and give people more options to educate their children to the best that they see fit using the dollars that they provide. The 21st Century Community Learning Center seems to be preparing children in a way that improves their learning ability and helps them move forward as they go through the school system and perform better and get better grades.
Okay. The next question will be answered first by Rebecca. What are your plans for the discipline policy in Unified School?
It's a great question, and it's
they're all submitted by the public.
Yes. Well, I'm glad somebody submitted that question because I have many concerns. I think what we really need to address for discipline is the accountability for our students' behavior. We have to teach our children what discipline is. Discipline is something that it's a learning process. You teach and you learn, and some of our children are better. They have this intrinsic ability to follow the rules and do what they need to do. I have children of my own that are a wide variety of in that behavior range. So I have to work very hard as a parent to communicate with one of my children at the school level, and I never had to do hardly any with another. So I just think it's a huge responsibility for everyone to take buy-in into that process. We can't tell the teachers that the problem lies with you. We need to be a united front, set high standards, and create a plan that's going to hold children accountable. The middle school is one of my biggest concerns. I think that students need to be able to be held more accountable. There are opportunities where after school, maybe if you're not doing your classwork, things of that nature, then you stay after school. If you do something wrong, you get a detention. There's got to be a consequence connected to behavior that interrupts teaching in the classroom. I used to tell my kids this every single day when they went to school. You are there at school to get an education. That's your number one responsibility. The socializing and all that is second nature. You have to make sure you do what you're supposed to and follow the rules. We need to put some strong measures in to help support students and teachers, parents, and the community coming together to hold everyone accountable for these very important pieces of discipline in our schools. Thank you.
David.
Thank you. I do believe let me start that over. We need to be tougher on our students. What I mean by that is I think the kids get away with more than they should. When I go through the schools, when I talk to other teachers, I know they definitely get away with more stuff than they did when I was there. And we can't blame the teachers for all the discipline problems we're having. Actually, the discipline is a very good thing that should be top-down. It needs to start at the top and trickle down. But then at the school level, the teachers need to have the support of the administrators. I think we let the kids get away with too much. I don't think we're tough enough on the ones that need disciplining. I don't think we have rules in place that deal with this thing. And when I say thing, I mean a discipline problem. The teachers aren't being supported enough here. We know it, at least I know it. I think other board members believe that to be true also. But again, you can't just blame the teacher. This is definitely a problem that needs to be corrected, not only so much at school, but more at home. And I think we need to reach out to some of these families and help them. If they need the help, then we need to help support them with their student, because it's going to help us out when we get them back into our buildings. But I do think it's something we've got to look at our policies, and we have to change the way that we're taking care of the kids.
Sam.
Discipline's my number one issue. With class sizes increasing, you cannot have kids disrupting the class. It's something that doesn't cost any more, sending them down to the principal's office. You don't need more teachers to increase the discipline level. So discipline, we definitely need to tighten the rope on that. We should be looking at other districts, how they solve their discipline problems. I'd like to see what the most strict district did and how they solve some of their problems. We need to track it and be more accurate on how we track it. If you send someone out of classroom, it should be noted. We shouldn't wait to see what the principal says, send them back to the classroom. They should be addressed immediately.
Thank you. William.
In my talk with teachers, I've been able to sense their frustration that they're limited in the things that they can do. Why in a class of 25 children should one of them be able to disrupt the education of the other 24? The parents also need to become more involved in this, because ultimately it's their responsibility. And they need to teach their children, with the help of the district, that there's consequences for their actions. The teacher's frustration comes from not being able to do things beyond what the policy says, and we need to give them more options to deal with disruptive students so that they don't disrupt the majority in the process of their education.
Kyle.
The first thing that definitely needs to be done, and I mentioned it in my open statement, is a major updating of policy, specifically the 5000 series of policy and policy 1600, visitors. Every policy that exists and is updated must be strictly enforced, and administration has to be held accountable for doing that. Behavioral issues should always be documented. From what I understand, they are not currently. They must always be documented, and it is extremely important to communicate with the family. If there's a problem at home, the district needs to know about it, and they need to do their best to get that family to fix it. That goes right along with behavior. A well-behaved school is a safe school, and safety needs to be enhanced. We need to increase security. We need to update policies on personal technology, policies that just don't make sense for the 21st century.
Okay. The final question will begin with David. What is your opinion of year-round schools?
That's a good one, because when I first ran 3 years ago, I was all for it. Since then, I have done some research on it. Actually, the board was given a book on it not too long ago, which I've read, and I am in favor of year-round school. There's a lot of research out there that would suggest it's one of the best ways to close the education gap. It as an urban district as we are, it's one of the best ways to keep the kids engaged. We don't need that break, that 2 month break. Now, you still would be spread out differently. You wouldn't go nonstop. It's more like a four semesters or trimesters like they have in college. there are some limitations to it. We've got buildings that don't have any air conditioning. That's going to be an issue. And to put that in would be quite expensive. People's vacation schedules, teacher contract that is going to be changed, I understand. There's a lot of hurdles to cover, but as a whole, I'm very much in favor of year-round schooling. Even in the summer vacation, luckily we had grants to do it, but you know, we feed these kids even in summer school, because again, being an urban district, there's children that don't eat unless the school's feeding them. There's kids that have absolutely no contact with any books unless it's given to them by the school. Year-round schooling solves a lot of those problems. So I am in favor of it.
Sam? I am not in favor of year-round school, and because I believe in choice. And one of the choices that I would make that'd be a little bit different than that is to increase summer school, the availability of it, the classes. Some parents rely on their kids to go out and get a job, pay for their car insurance. Businesses look for that type of employment, that type of thing. I think instead of having year-round school, yes or no, I think there's a lot more options to fill that gap, to get kids engaged.
Thank you. William?
Well, going back to my main theme, my question would be, will the cost to the taxpayers improve the children's education that much? That's the first thing to be considered, because the taxpayers don't have any more money. The state's not giving us any more money. The federal government funds have been cut considerably from 2011-2012 to this year. Comes down to the money. If it's worth it, if it's going to work, then let's do it. If you can't show me that it will or it can, I'm going to have second thoughts about it. But if it does work, and the fiscal concerns are addressed, I'm all for it.
Kyle?
Year-round schooling is something that I can't give a full answer on, because I haven't read all of the research on it, so I would definitely need to read more research on it. However, right now, based on what I know, I would be against year-round schooling. I worry that when we're already in a budget crisis, that it wouldn't exactly be the best thing. Like Mr. Gallo mentioned, air conditioning would become a necessity. There's the issue of vacations. From what I understand, being a very recent student, the support from students and teachers isn't really there for year-round schooling. So it's something that I'm not sure if I can support right now, but I would definitely need to read more research on it.
Rebecca?
Well, I'm a strong proponent of getting the most bang for your buck when it comes, all along I am, but especially in tight budget crunches like we're in. Currently, we do have two schools, Frank and Wilson, that are doing year-round schooling. I believe we're headed into our third year with that. So I am requesting a follow-up and some data and information to see what type of impact that the extra dollars put into year-round schooling have, and do they create an environment that helps, especially with the Frank and the Wilson district, helps these children that might lose larger chunks of their learning over the summer, because we don't always get the opportunities to be exposed to the reading, to the different opportunities, maybe going to museums, all the different types of learning. Some people, when they go on family vacations over the summer, they get that opportunity to bring their kids to a lot of different places where they have educational experiences that help build their skills for learning. Many of our students don't get that opportunity. So I would look at where we're at right now with the two schools we have, get that data back, see how much money is being spent, make sure that money is being spent extremely wise. And I don't want a child to be hungry and to lose out on education over the summer. So again, I think it's something that you have to look at it individually with the two schools we currently have and see how effective it is and what it does to support our students.
Thank you. We'll now move on to closing statements, up to 3 minutes for each candidate, and we will begin with Sam.
Thank you, Carol, for moderating. This is our first forum. There will probably be plenty more after that. If you want more information about me, go to samuelpetermartin.com. That's a good start. I've been active in the community for many years. I serve on a lot of boards. I've attended a lot of meetings, chaired them. And I think I bridged some of the gaps that are falling right now. Leadership, community involvement. I think that's the biggest challenge that's going on right now, is bridging the gap between what the community needs and wants and what the direction of the district is going. Thank you.
William.
The days of special interest representation on the KUSD board are over. No longer will education be run in the best interest of the adults. It will return to being all about the children and what it takes to get the most out of every dollar provided by the taxpayer. I've got questions for the board, the administration, and the teachers. I've got questions about budget, payments to consultants, employee travel, vehicle lease payments, and the size of the administration. I've got questions about class size, student discipline, early end of day on Fridays, vouchers, the waiting list for charter schools, and the 21st Century Community Learning Centers. I've got questions about school security, health insurance, sick days, and staffing, like what do 83.9 miscellaneous employees do? And those are only the beginning. Some answers will be easy, others not so much. Each answer about expenditure or policy will include what the benefit to the children and their quality of education. With my election to the KUSD board, those providing the resources used to provide the children the tools they need for a productive future will have a voice of common sense, and a concern for the only special interest that counts. It's all about the children. My name is William Maurer, and I've got questions.
Thank you. Kyle.
As I said, I'm running on the ideas of improving academic excellence, not just proficiency, by transforming the transformation plan, prioritizing funding to lower class size and put more money into security, updating and strictly enforcing policies, and increasing communication with teachers, parents, and students. I am a recent student of KUSD, a very recent student, so I'm the only candidate who has been directly affected by many of the issues facing the district right now. I'm also a major advocate against division, which this board clearly is. We need to come together so that we can solve problems. If you'd like to know more about me, you can visit me on Facebook, Kyle Flood for KUSD School Board, or visit my website, www.kyleflood4kusd.com.
Thank you. Rebecca.
Yes, I'd like to thank you and the other people that are also running for school board. I think it's really important that people are involved in their community and serve our community in this manner. It's a big challenge right now, school board, with the budget cuts from the state and all the changes within the district. We need to work together, and we need to look at what is the very best plan that we can support for the best bang for your buck, and still continuing to support the high quality of education for each and every student. I feel like at this point, if we can get back to the table and we can talk and confer and meet and share our concerns, that's the way we're going to be able to look at how we're going to problem solve, how we're going to move into this 21st century learning that we're talking about. But we need to have all groups represented. We need to have transparency, great communication. And when I say great communication, there's a lot of listening with great communication. We don't always have to agree. There's nothing wrong with having an opposing view. That's why we're here. I like to tell the story about the Bill of Rights. There wouldn't be one if we didn't have three dissenting votes. It's very important. That's what a democracy is about. I want to continue to do the work. I want to tweak out the transformation plan, make it stronger and better by addressing the concerns that the community, parents, teachers, students, me as a board member, and everyone are bringing forward. We can do this, and we can make our district stronger and better. Again, opposing views are not the worst thing in the world. I think it's really great to bring a group of people together to problem solve and to listen and work together. Thank you.
David.
Thank you. Our district is changing fast. Over the next 12 months, this district definitely will not look the way it looks today. More changes coming. Times will be short. Quick decisions are going to have to be made. None of these are fun, easy things to do. But we need to stay steadfast to our goals that we've set up. We need to keep moving forward, and we need to stay positive. It's been years since the financing of this district has looked as good as it does today. It's been years since we've been able to add teachers back to the classroom. That's coming. Our financial position is improving. We'll be able to reduce class sizes. There's so many other good things going. There's a lot that we can talk about, but we have a lot more to do. All of this is possible because we're able to reallocate some of our funds. Without being able to do that, most of this wouldn't be taking place. And I think that's very important for everyone to remember. The reallocation of our funds are what really going to help drive this district. But again, it brings along a lot of changes. And change isn't easy. But what we don't have time for is board members to go through a learning curve. And we definitely don't have room for any special interest groups. We have some very serious changes that need to be made, and we need serious people to make them. My name is David Gallo. I'm asking you to hire me for another 3 years so I can keep us on course and keep us improving. Thank you.
I'd like to thank all the candidates for participating today. And I would remind everyone to vote in the primary on February 19th. You will be able to vote for two candidates. I'm Carl Frederick. Thank you for watching.